Everybody, this is Charlene Burke with Grow Because You Know. That's www.growbecauseyouknow.com. Welcome to Morning Mindset Cafe, where we read a few pages of Napoleon Hill's Think and Grow Rich. Today, we're reading from my version of the book, pages 231 to 235, and we're going to be reviewing the symptoms of fear of poverty. Let's get started, shall we? Of all the ages of the world of which we know anything, the age in which we live seems to be one that is outstanding because of man's money madness. A man is considered less than the dust of the earth unless he can display a fat bank account. But if he has money, never mind how he acquired it, he is a king or a big shot. He is above the law. He rules in politics. He dominates in business, and the whole world about him bows in respect when he passes. Nothing brings man so much suffering and humility as poverty. Only those who have experienced poverty understand the full meaning of this. It is no wonder that man fears poverty. Through a long line of inherited experiences, man has learned for sure that some men cannot be trusted where matters of money and earthly possessions are concerned. This is a rather stinging indictment, the worst part of it being that it's true. The majority of marriages are motivated by the wealth possessed by one or both of the contracting parties. It is no wonder, therefore, that the divorce courts are busy. So eager is man to possess wealth that he will acquire it in whatever manner he can, through legal methods if possible, through other methods if necessary or expedient. Self-analysis may disclose weaknesses which one does not like to acknowledge. This form of examination is essential to all who demand of life more than mediocrity and poverty. Remember, as you check yourself point by point, that you are both the court and the jury, the prosecuting attorney and the attorney for the defense, and that you are the plaintiff and the defendant, also that you are on trial. Face the facts squarely, ask yourself definite questions, and demand direct replies. When the examination is over, you will know more about yourself. If you do not feel that you can be an impartial judge in this self-examination, call upon someone who knows you well to serve as judge while you cross-examine yourself. You are after the truth. Get it, no matter at what cost, even though it may temporarily embarrass you. The majority of people, if asked what they fear most, would reply, "I fear nothing." The reply would be inaccurate because few people realize that they are bound, handicapped, whipped spiritually and physically through some sort of fear. So subtle and deeply seated is the emotion of fear that one may go through life burdened with it, never recognizing its presence. Only a courageous analysis will disclose the presence of this universal enemy. When you begin such an analysis, search deeply into your character. Here is a list of the symptoms for which you should look. Symptoms of the fear of poverty. Indifference, commonly expressed through lack of ambition, willingness to tolerate poverty, acceptance of whatever compensation life may offer without protest, mental and physical laziness, lack of initiative, imagination, enthusiasm, and self-control. Indecision, the habit of permitting others to do one's thinking, staying on the fence. Doubt, generally expressed through alibis and excuses designed to cover up, explain away, or apologize for one's failures. Sometimes expressed in the form of envy for those who are successful or by criticizing them. Worry, usually expressed by finding fault with others. A tendency to spend beyond one's income, neglect of personal appearance. Scowling and frowning, intemperance in the use of alcoholic drink, sometimes through the use of narcotics, nervousness, lack of poise, self-consciousness, and lack of self-reliance. Overcaution, the habit of looking for the negative side of every circumstance, thinking and talking of possible failure instead of concentrating upon the means of succeeding, knowing all the roads to disaster, but never searching for the plans to avoid failure. Waiting for the right time to begin putting ideas and plans into action until the waiting becomes a permanent habit. Remembering those who have failed and forgetting those who have succeeded. Seeing the hole in the donut but overlooking the donut. Pessimism leading to indigestion, poor elimination, auto-intoxication, bad breath, and bad disposition. Procrastination. The habit of putting off until tomorrow that which should have been done last year. Spending enough time and creating alibis and excuses to have done the job. This symptom is closely related to overcaution, doubt, and worry. Refusal to accept responsibility when it can be avoided. Willingness to compromise rather than put up a stiff fight. Compromising with difficulties instead of harnessing and using them as stepping stones to advancement. Bargaining with life for a penny instead of demanding prosperity, opulence, riches, contentment, and happiness. Planning what to do if and when overtaken by failure, instead of burning all bridges and making retreat impossible. Weakness of an often total lack of self-confidence, definiteness of purpose, self-control, initiative, enthusiasm, ambition, thrift, and sound reasoning ability. Expecting poverty instead of demanding riches. Association with those who accept poverty instead of seeking the company of those who demand and receive riches. Money talks. Some will ask, why did you write a book about money? Why measure riches in dollars alone? Some will believe, and rightly so, that there are other forms of riches more desirable than money. Yes, there are riches which cannot be measured in terms of dollars, but there are millions of people who will say, give me all the money I need and I will find everything else I want. The major reason why I wrote this book on how to get money is the fact that the world has but lately passed through an experience that left millions of men and women paralyzed with the fear of poverty. What this sort of fear does to one was well described by Westbrook Pegler in the New York World Telegram. Money is only clamshells or metal discs or scraps of paper, and there are treasures of the heart and soul which money cannot buy. But most people, being broke, are unable to keep this in mind and sustain their spirits. When a man is down and out and on the street, unable to get any job at all, something happens to his spirit which can be observed in the droop of his shoulders, the set of his hat, his walk, his gaze. He cannot escape a feeling of inferiority among people with regular employment, even though he knows they are definitely not his equals in character, intelligence, or ability. These people, even his friends, feel, on the other hand, a sense of superiority and regard him, perhaps unconsciously, as a casualty. He may borrow for a time, but not enough to carry on in his accustomed way, and he cannot continue to borrow very long. But borrowing in itself, when a man is borrowing merely to live, is a depressing experience, and the money lacks the power of earned money to revive his spirits. Of course, none of this applies to bums or habitual ne'er-do-wells, but only to men of normal ambitions and self-respect. Women conceal despair. Women in the same predicament must be different. We somehow do not think of women at all in considering the down-and-outers. They are scarce in the breadlines, they rarely are seen begging on the streets, and they're not recognizable in crowds by the same plain signs which identify busted men. Of course, I do not mean the shuffling hags of the city streets, who are the opposite number of the confirmed male bums. I mean reasonably young, decent, and intelligent women. There must be many of them, but their despair is not apparent. Maybe they kill themselves. When a man is down and out, he has time on his hands for brooding. He may travel miles to see a man about a job and discover that the job is filled, or that it is one of those jobs with no base pay, but only a commission on the sale of some useless knick-knack, which nobody would buy except out of pity. Turning that down, he finds himself back on the street with nowhere to go but just anywhere. So he walks and walks. He gazes into store windows at luxuries which are not for him, and feels inferior and gives way to people who stop to look at with an active interest. He wanders into the railroad station or puts himself down in the library to ease his legs and soak up a little heat. But that isn't looking for a job, so he gets going again. He may not know it, but his aimlessness would give him away even if the very lines of his figure did not. He may be well-dressed and the clothes left over from the days when he had a steady job, but the clothes cannot disguise the droop. Money makes a difference. He sees thousands of other people, bookkeepers or clerks or chemists or wagon hands, busy at their work and envies them from the bottom of his soul. They have their independence, their self-respect and manhood, and he simply cannot convince himself that he is a good man too, though he argue it out and arrive at a favorable verdict hour after hour. It is just money which makes this difference in him. With a little money, he would be himself again. Some employers take the most shocking advantage of people who are down and out. The agencies hang out little colored cards offering miserable wages to busted men. $12 a week, $15 a week. An $18 a week job is a plum. Anyone with $25 a week to offer does not hang the job in front of an agency on a colored card. I have a want ad clipped from a local paper demanding a clerk, a good, clean penman, to take telephone orders for a sandwich shop from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. for $8 a month. Not $8 a week, but $8 a month. The ad also says, state religion. Can you imagine the brutal effrontery of anyone who demands a good, clean penman for 11 cents an hour requiring an inquiring into the victim's religion? But that is what busted people are offered. I'm going to stop there and hope that I can still be seen and heard. Good morning, everybody. Hi, Jeremy. Eric Rashi, good to see you here. Walter, welcome, Muhammad. Ebony, good to see you here. Hanadi, glad you're here. So, it's one. That's just one symptom of poverty. Or should I say, it's a fear, right? The fear of poverty. The symptoms were listed as indifference, indecision, doubt, worry, overcaution, procrastination. With a nice description of each, and I was a little surprised to see myself in a couple of those. And then the newspaper article. Now, what sort of fear does this do to someone? What does it look like? You know, and the newspaper article, and at the time, the New York World Telegram described it pretty well. It's demoralizing, right? Yes. Good morning, Chuck. So glad you're here. I think that's part of what I heard as I was reading that description of the fella without a job. He can be dressed up and looking for work. Doesn't matter what you look like. The inside is still feeling demoralized and inferior. I personally am one that believes that work provides us with dignity and purpose. And if it's as a business owner, that's my work. If it is as an employee, that's my work. It provides me an opportunity to be of service and to be of use. So when there is no job, what are you supposed to do with yourself, right? I think the other thing that really, really strikes me is that the description was so close to what we've been experiencing in the United States. Still experiencing in some sectors. Others are prospering. Not everybody's caught up yet. Money does make a difference. Okay, and then one other thing that caught my attention is the wondering, what the heck do women do with themselves? Because we don't see them out here doing what men do, wandering around, looking in the window shops, all of that. Maybe they kill themselves. Yeah, that caught my attention. Oh, no, Matt, you're pulsing. I'm hoping it's you pulsing and not me. Good morning, Sean. All right, need somebody in the comments section to tell me that you can hear me and see me. Just say yes. Good. All right, then it's Matt. All right, Matt, try again, my friend. Thank you. Hello, Scott. Scott Attenborough, good to see you here. So glad you could make it. I know you're usually pretty busy this time of day. Oh, Michelle, celebrate. Today, celebrate. Yes. There you are. Yeah, big yay for Scott. He made it. All right, come on, Matt. I don't know what's going on, Matt. You made it in earlier, obviously, because I made you a co-host, because I wasn't coming in. But there are other seats for those who'd like to jump in and comment. Wow. Okay, I'm Xing you out to see if maybe that makes a difference. Try again if you haven't already refreshed. Anybody else want to jump in and just share some comments or thoughts about what was read?
Is it a pulsing? What is it?
There he is. Persistence works. Good to see you.
Huh.
Yeah. Okay. It was your turn.
Yeah. So one of the things I was thinking about might just be the internet connection here. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
That description of man losing his spirit when he loses his job, I think it has to do with when people confuse their intrinsic value and their economic value. Because when people mm-hmm. don't have a job, they think they don't have any value to offer because they have a sense of separation between those who do have jobs and those who don't. So when a man is down and out and in the street and is able to get a job, his spirit breaks because he's constantly comparing his sense of value to everybody else that's different, uh-huh. that has a job. He can't escape a feeling of inferiority because he's defining his sense of self on the fact that he can't create any value. But see, that's taking something intrinsic, which all human beings have, and labeling it as economic, which is the value you create in the marketplace or whatever you're doing. So when you see somebody that's successful, it's because they've had a consistent economic value of creation, that their wealth and their status and their perks are much higher than somebody mm-hmm. who's down at the bottom. And if you don't see inspiration and success from that, then you're probably taking your intrinsic value as a human being and you're defining that as that difference, which isn't healthy for your spirit and
nice.
Sense of not being afraid of poverty. I don't know what to think of the women thing though. I don't know.
I don't know what they do. Maybe they just kill themselves.
You just glossed right over that.
Well, you know, I almost busted out laughing when I read it out loud. I just kept on going.
Maybe the women aren't on the streets and they're actually working and creating some sort of value, you know? Maybe you don't see them because they're actually doing something.
Now, remembering the times, he wasn't going to go out and try to find out what the women were doing. That wasn't important.
Yeah.
I understand that. I think today it has been done. What are the women doing? The women are gathering together. They're getting little cottage industries going. They took advantage of the internet. Yeah. You know how many women entrepreneurs jumped online? Yeah. They didn't care what it cost. They hit Fiverr, they hit Odesk, which is now Upwork. They hit forums. You know, I drop in on forums and these women are saying, I can do this, I can do this. How much money can you give me? I'll take it.
Yeah.
I'll take it, whatever it takes. And then started the little cottage industries. That's where all the women went. Today's world in response to the recession. So I have no doubt that the same thing applies to the women of that time. That's where they went door to door selling the eggs when they, you know, they cooked up the chicken and they sold people.
They got to work.
You know, they went out and they were doing the gardens. They were working in some capacity in the household. Some of it brought in money, some of it didn't. Mm-hmm. But again, it was the times and the focus. Perfectly okay. I think the demoralization of somebody as it relates to their inability to contribute happens.
Mm-hmm. I think women are, I've done youth leadership for a long time since middle school, and a lot of the FCCLA, which is the Family Career Community Leaders of America, which is just one of like 11 career and technical organizations. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of women in the organization. Like it's gotta be probably 80 to 85% women, and they're all really smart and they're all very cooperative. I think there's more of a sense of a connection and communication between them than like men being independent and competing and not trusting anybody. Right. I don't know. It just seems like women are more likely to cooperate and communicate well, like on YouTube and Blab. And there are a lot of YouTubers that are just women and watch a lot of women YouTubers because they like to create content and connect and everything. And I've seen that in women are more self-disciplined. I'm convinced they're more self-disciplined.
Well, I like Nick. That's
and, we can't argue with that.
I think you're right. Generalizations can be dangerous.
They
but
are.
We have to generalize. All you have to do, look at anecdotally, just as Matt described. Look at a group of women and look at a group of men. Listen to what they're talking about and listen to what the men are talking about. Now give them a problem to solve and watch how they solve their problem. And
yeah, we have to be like an ethics of justice versus an ethics of care, because I think that caring mentality isn't as, I don't know if that has to do with like a more oxytocin maybe and more brain chemicals that are more about caring, but
well, Yeah,
It just
there's it's
seems, I don't
we're
know.
different. We're different. And that's where it comes that, you know, mom is always the one everybody thinks. Mom's the nurturer. Mom's the one that handles the home front. Mom's the one that makes sure everything's coordinated. She handles the schedule. She makes sure that the kids are covered, the husband's covered, you know, even when she's working, she's doing her work at home. All of that, you know, it comes honestly. And the recognition that great leadership is part of a woman's nature as well. Take charge, do things. They just tend to do it in the background. I'm not going to get stuck on that. The
All
idea
right.
is that my thought is that bringing, I don't know that I want to get rid of the idea that my value isn't, can be measured by society. Because you see, in what the what I read there tells me that I look at you the same way. So if a man is down and out and he's looking for work and he feels kicked to the curb, he can continue to look for work, but those who know he's out of work feel more superior, which of course is simply because I don't know, I happen to be where I am and I'm not recognizing that any minute now, or I am recognizing any minute now I could be you. I see it all the time, even today, where people are trying to find work and it just isn't there. And the other group that says you need to go find a job, and even I'm like, have you seen the town the kid is in? You know, there isn't where, you know,
Circumstances, yeah.
let's send him 50 bucks so that he can get car fare or gas, or you know, it's going to take 50 to 100 bucks, get a bus ticket and go to another town and start over there. You know, now that was me. I would tell people that and they just thought I was absolutely nuts. I'm like, well then, you know, those are your options. But
There's a lot of circumstances involved with people's ability to find work and the skills that they have. There are a lot of factors involved. Sometimes you just gotta move. Sometimes
there
you just gotta
is.
go somewhere else. All right, I'm all
Yes.
set. I'll let somebody else hop in here.
Well, thanks for stopping by, Matt. You know, I
You're
appreciate
welcome.
you. So yeah, you know, is this a symptom? You know, we can get stuck on the story that was written, or hey, you know what? He listed out there's a reason we fear poverty. But how does that fear express itself? How can we, are we in it now? Are any of these symptoms in us today? I recognize me in a few of those. And I realized, yes, that's what I've been learning over these past months of reading this and having you participate in the discussion is that, yeah, that's me in some ways. Oh, there's something that really is suddenly glaring. And I need to take a look at this and change it. Good morning, Steve. Glad to have you with us. Art, welcome. I believe you're new here. And Magna Wave. That's an interesting name. Good to have you here. Lee? Yes. Poor, broke, poverty. You know, I've not lived in poverty. I don't know what real poverty is because poverty is the absolute certainty that nothing can change, that I haven't had that. I've been broke. And have had moments where I actually felt poor, where there was a possibility it wasn't going to improve. But most of the time, it's just the broke, which I know is temporary. And because my experience says it's temporary, but I think also it's our thinking. And that's the whole point of the book, right? Our thinking. So, you know, somebody wants to talk about that, what we read, jump in the seat. You want to talk about anything else? Hold off. Maybe go to another blab. What we're talking about is symptoms of fear of poverty that were listed out by Napoleon Hill. Hey, Lucinda. Good to meet you. Glad you're here. Carolian? Carolian? Carolian. I know I mangled it. My apologies. So, symptoms, indifference. You know, lack of ambition, accepting whatever compensation life offers. Okay, that's not me. I can tell you that. It's no. Indecision. There's the big one for me that really showed itself was that that the indecision because of doubt and the overcaution. that's what really glared out at me of the things that I have struggled with and overcome in some cases, but not totally, which is why I'm still here talking to you all. Hi, Michelle. Good morning.
Good morning, Miss Charlene. How are you? I don't know. I'm kind of in a weird spot here.
You're good.
This is a great subject because I actually have, I'm on my phone, so I don't typically get on my phone. So I don't know how to do this on my phone.
It's awkward, isn't it?
Computer. Yeah, it's weird. I'm usually on my computer. So it's amazing because all those qualities, I don't know if they're qualities, that
symptoms.
List symptoms, but I see that in people that I work with that literally don't want to work. I have
the ones that want to sit back and just accept. Are you talking about those on welfare? Those who,
yes, not even those on welfare that actually are maybe have investments. And I have a couple of people that have pretty high investments in several different industries.
Okay.
And they're not getting the return that they want, but instead of going out and supplementing and contributing to society, they're waiting for the big load, right? And there's no humility. There's indifference. You listed all of these symptoms, but there's not enough humility to go and actually get a job compared to the mother load or compared to a career. And it is an amazing,
wait a second. It's not the fact that I had I had money and I invested. And the purpose of the investment is to grow to a point where that's my definite purpose is to hit that dollar amount.
That's right.
Investments, right? But I have no interest in doing anything else with myself. I'm just going to sit and wait for it to happen no matter what it looks like. Wow. Oh, wow.
Yes. And it's a pretty interesting behavior to watch because there's all the list is there, the entire list, except and there wasn't humility on this list because humility will actually bring you to a point of, okay, I need to do something.
Yeah, humility is the honest assessment of who you are, your abilities, and your strengths and your weaknesses. It's just an honest assessment.
It is, but when there's not that component,
yeah,
then we're all in poverty. It doesn't matter what level we're at, you know.
Right.
You know,
yes, because you lack that ability to say that. I like what Steve says. Well, of course I do, because it has to do with learning, right? But
exactly.
I know an awful lot. I know an awful lot. And I know I'm very skilled in a lot of areas, but I also know that I don't know squat about
exactly.
An awful lot. And that I need to go out and learn it if I'm going to do it. You know, if I don't have that now. So that's what I mean by that honest assessment.
Right. Wow. Yeah, it's pretty interesting. And I'm a human behavior. I love watching human behavior. And that's why I do what I do. But I'd be honest with you, it's frustrating as well when I see an unwillingness to participate in contributing not only to the family value, but to society. And
well, and you're looking at it as those who have money.
Exactly.
And it's the same feeling you're expressing,
it's the same feeling
that I have when I get, but out of you, I'm what's resonating with me is I sometimes get that same feeling to pop them on the side of the head that
exactly.
Out of those that truly are lazy, that they are, but it's not just lazy. It's the sense of it's not even the sense of entitlement. It is the indifference.
It's the indifference.
But it's more than that. It's not the hopelessness. It's like, you know, this is what it is. They don't have any imagination or enthusiasm to go do anything. It's like,
there's zero drive. And
yeah, there it is. Yeah.
Zero drive.
See, that's Hannity. That's what we're talking about. It's not really lazy. It's
no ambition.
Drive to do something, to be of use someplace. And yet instead to, you know, the preference is I'm just going to be a lump here and I'm going to wait for it to happen. And all right. So I know a lot of people like that and they don't have money in my area. I've referred to my area as the $12 an hour town. And that is the mentality of you just be happy with what you get.
Right.
Be happy with what you get. You don't, you know, if you talk about wanting more, well, who are you? Who are you to want more?
Right.
See, I get that. I still get that today, but I'm cautious about who I'm around as well. So when I now hear it from those that have that mentality, it's like, yeah, you're the ones I don't want to be around. Just, I'm going to keep going this way towards the one that say, go, 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 Charlene, be better, be more than what you are now. It's those who say that I have more than they do. So why would I want even more than what I have?
Right.
And
but there's a whole new generation of what we call digital nomads, and they mm-hmm. do nothing but make money on the internet, which is great, but they live in countries outside of their own.
Yes.
And I'm speaking, I've got a couple of people that I'm...
Oh, I've got a couple of people like that, I know.
Okay, yes. That live outside the United States, take advantage of these countries and live it up over there, okay, which is great, but do not become involved in anything on any type of level. Do not learn to speak their language. Do not learn to do anything other than to try to find the tax loopholes to live abroad.
Yeah, I know a couple of those, and I don't listen very closely to them. They don't have much to offer to me because they don't have much to talk about.
No, and that's what, but that's part of what there's a, that's the new quote unquote. That's this, there's a generation out there that's creating that.
In a sense. Oh, thank you, Nick. I appreciate that. Can I do a, I just took a screenshot. Yes, I did. All right. So.
Yes, they believe they can do it. Yes, they totally believe they can do it.
But all right. So I know quite a few digital nomads, and I could say that I've seen the ones you're talking about. But honestly, even the young ones, I'm talking 22, 24, 25-year-old young men who are setting up foundations. You know, they haven't made their million yet. They've made a couple of hundred thousand on the internet. And they're letting me know that they're going to go ahead and start this foundation that they give to organizations like Kiva.
And that's wonderful. That's wonderful.
Yeah, but those are the ones that I know. I know families. That have been digital nomads for years. Some are, I can list a good handful that are millionaires and doing wonderful things. They, one in particular is a family. They set up a foundation strictly for educating young people that there's more than going to school and being a production worker. You can be more. And if you don't want to be, that's okay. But at least you're going to know there's a choice.
Right.
That's their feeling. And then there's another one that they travel country to country to country, and the kids are awesome. And she's been digital for years, and she has no interest in making a lot of money. She's perfect.
Yeah,
it's not the money. It's the experience.
It's the experience.
Yeah, so
and I'm not putting down digital nomads. I would love to be.
I didn't hear you do that.
Are you
but
kidding me?
I'm trying to think of the one or two that I might know. I know a couple I've come across, but honestly, they're not a part of my circle.
Yeah, well, mine are not, but I have on the fringes, and I see.
Yeah. And you see it growing, and I haven't.
I haven't noticed that.
Interesting.
It's pretty interesting because it's the same. Feeling again, it goes back to the indifference, and not all of them, you know, not all of them, but it goes back to poverty doesn't mean you are without money. It's a mindset, I believe. It's a mindset. So,
but what you're talking about when you pulled that out is it is the fear of poverty, and what Napoleon Hill said earlier, which is a man is considered less than the dust of the earth unless he can display a fat bank account, never mind how he acquired it. And that also goes to this fascination over the past 20 years or so, 30 years in our world, our generation today, of the sports figures getting huge dollar amounts and being okay with that. But it's perfectly, it's great to bash a corporate guy making that
right.
Much, but
right.
Hey, you know, the guy can dunk a ball. So, you know.
That's right.
Really?
That's right.
So now there I can see the followers of the sports figures like that being that indifference, that the reason they want it is to get out of the poverty. It's to have the money, not to be better. Okay. Okay.
Yeah. So anyway, yeah, that's my take on it. I'm going to pop out, let somebody else. It's great seeing you, Charlene.
Oh,
I'll catch
thank you
guys another time. Okay.
Good to see you. Welcome, Eric. Good to see you here, Eric Grill. Always good to see you, my friend. Mia?
You might have to, I don't know, you have to clog me
up. You want
out
me to get you out?
Kick me out, Charlene, please.
I'm going to kick you out just because you asked. We'll see you later. Jim, yes, Jim Skaggs. Good to see you here. So that was interesting. I never considered those with money having these symptoms, which are directly related to the fear of poverty. And I should have, because honestly, that's the whole reason why I want to be making the money I want to make, the way I want to make it, which is along the lines of the principles of Napoleon Hill, which is I'm going to be better. And as I grow, my financial account grows. So it's more than just the money. And I didn't go there. I was stuck on the story about the fellow without a job, right? And the despair, because I believe that honest work brings dignity to any one of us, whether that work is for pay or in exchange for a seat at the table. If you're unable to, of course, it's an entirely different story. But if you're able-bodied and able-minded, in some, especially in today's world with the internet, able-minded, then doing something, you know, back to nothing is free. So if you're handed something, what's the cost? The cost is a little bit of my dignity. That's where my brain went with that. And that's because nobody's sitting in the seat to share their stuff with me. You also need to know I'm not going to be able to hold the room open today. It is Wednesday. So that means that at 9 o'clock, at the top of the hour, I have to open up another room on Zoom. We have our professional business networking meeting. It happens today. I'll be sharing that link shortly. So I'm going to be shutting this down, you know, a few minutes early. So if you have something that you want to throw out there, be it in the comment section or more preferably in the open seat, please do. So symptoms of poverty, indifference, indecision. I told you that's the one that hit me. Most of you who've been with me on my journey through this book know that doubt and indecision have been the biggest battle I've had. Worry. And then procrastination. And I admit, I still, you know, planning what to do if and when overtaken by failure instead of burning all the bridges and making retreat impossible. Pretty close to burning the bridges. I alluded to it yesterday. I'm like this close to busting out the changeover of becoming Charlene Burke. Instead of, you know, the business name. And that's been happening this year, and I'm getting used to the idea, and I'm getting used to me being out there. It's going to be one of those things, you know, let me say it this way. That procrastination, what's always interesting to me is once I make the decision and take action on it, I always look back and say, why didn't I do that sooner? I knew what to do. What held me back? What fear held me back? I think that's interesting. Steve, you got my hopes up that you were going to be there, and now you're telling me you can't. Well, it has to do with the wife. Okay. How can I cannot complain about that. Next time, every Wednesday at 9 o'clock. Every Wednesday. 9 a.m. Eastern time, right after this. It's been going on for about 2 months now, and have some outstanding presenters. Excellent. So what do we think of those symptoms? All right, or we could go back to that article. money is the physical aspect of money at the time, we're talking back in the 20s and 30s, money's only clamshells or metal discs or scraps of paper, and yet without it, we're nothing. And we know that's not true. But what happens when we don't have any? What happens when we don't have any? That's a good question. And I think it was described pretty well that, and I like what Matt said about intrinsic and extrinsic value. And yet still today, in my mind, I know I am more than my bank account. But I got to tell you, when my bank account is healthy, I'm feeling a lot happier. I feel more freedom. Feel more freedom. And that's really what it means to me, is that I am not held back because of the lack of money, which, of course, now comes down to I am held back by what's between the ears, right? You knew I was going to go there. I think it's interesting. Usually you're a pretty talkative crowd. What's up? Not deep enough? Too deep? There she is. Uh-oh. Maybe. I'm checking my internet connection. Oh, no, hi, you're pulsing. I'm going to kick you out and ask you to try again. And if this time doesn't work, then ask you to refresh. It's just not working. All right. Try to refresh, huh? I'd love to have you on here. Yeah, something's up with Blab today. At least we all know, right? I am going to go ahead and give you all the link to join today's networking meeting immediately following this. It's on a different platform. It's called Zoom, similar to GoToMeeting, GoToWebinar. It begins at the top of the hour. So I've got about not quite 10 minutes to spend here before I go over to the networking meeting. Or sooner if nobody joins me. Come on. All right. How about this? Let me close down the recording and then we'll see if anybody comes in. If we've got anybody who's a little nervous about being camera ready. So this is Charlene Burke with Grow Because You Know. That's www.growbecauseyouknow.com. I want to thank Matt and Michelle for joining me in the live stream to talk about the symptoms of the fear of poverty and giving some great insight. And those in the comments section, thank you for doing so. Greatly appreciated as always. Those of you watching the replay, I hope you got something out of it. And remember that we are here every weekday morning at 8 a.m. Eastern time. Let's move forward with the day, shall we? On purpose, with purpose, to grow our hearts, grow our minds, and grow our businesses. Until next time.